I don't know how you guys think, but if I get a piece of analog equipment and I screw it open and look inside there, I immediately think like, wait, I can build this myself as well. And probably way cheaper. And well, that's what I'm going to do today. I'm going to build from the ground up an SSL bus compressor, a bit with my own twist to it. It's the GSSL compressor, so the design is by Gyref. And the kit that I'm using, I bought it from PCB Grinder, which I will link below all. Everything is purchased by me. There's no sponsored content in here. So just so you guys know. Before I'm going to run the bumper and start the project, I wanted to say one thing, and that is, if you want to do this yourself, make sure that you know about electricity. And most of all, about electrical safety. I am not schooled to teach about electric safety. I know a lot of stuff about electronic safety, but if you shock yourself and die because of that, then I am not responsible for that, because I'm only showing you the fun of building your own equipment, and nothing about electronic safety. So with that being said, let's get started. So in order to get started, it's maybe wise to first take a look at what we have. In terms of tools, I have the normal electronic tools like a wire cutter, a soldering iron, that kind of stuff. But what we need for the build is in this box, so it's kind of an unboxing. The first thing I see is the front plate. Let's leave this in the plastic for now. I want to leave this in the plastic as long as possible so that it doesn't get any scratches. We have a toroid transformer, which we will need in order to scale down the voltage from the mains, which is 230 volts here in Holland, all the way down to, what does this thing do? 15 volts, 2 times 15 volts, so we need 30 volts in total. So you have 15 volts above, so plus 15, 0 and minus 15. We're probably needing that for the op-amps. There are a lot of op-amps in here, and op-amps need a balanced voltage source. I think that's what it's called. What do we have more? A PCB grinder package. Within there is switches, so rotary switches. We have some tantal. I actually hate these types of capacitors because they always blow in vintage equipment, but these ones are new. Actually pretty expensive stuff, so that's okay. We have some switches. Let's put them to the side. Let's keep all the electronic components on here. So these are also switches, rotary switches. Then we have a whole bag full of all the knobs. Oh, the XLR connectors are in here as well. Let's put them also to the side. A lot of screws. We don't need them as well, not yet, because we first want to make the PCB, which is this one. So this is the GSSL PCB. Got a cool VU compression meter, because it's a 1HE box, so a small box. There's also a low profile compression meter in here. Let's put that one to the side as well. Ah, here we have capacitors, transistor, capacitors. So we are going to need those. And here we have a big bag full of all the other stuff. The thing is, there are a lot of different component values in such a kit, so that's why it looks so impressive. There are not a lot of components. If you see the most of the bags, there are only one or two components in here. You have 5 resistors, 1, 2. So it's not as spectacular as you might think. But we're still not there yet. We have these ones. And these ones are kind of interesting. These are the VCAs. But I'm not going to use them. Or I'm only going to use one of them. And the other two, I'll show you in a second. And the rest in the box is the side plates and the bottom plates. Now, from what I've heard, there are no holes in here. So I need to drill the holes for the PCB and the transformer and stuff, which is a bit of gives a lot of mess. Like if you buy a kit and you want to solder something, like soldering is okay. Drilling is like a different level, for me at least. Now, this is in theory all I need, but I wanted to spice it up a bit. So instead of these little VCAs, I'm going to use these VCAs. These are DBX 202C VCAs. They are vintage. This is what they look like. I bought them on eBay. They were not cheap, and I hope I won't blow them up. The reason why I'm using these is because the original SSL bus compressor also had DBX VCAs in them, the 202s. The original one had the 202 XT. Those ones are really hard to get, and the PCB is already pre-made for this VCA. As you can see over here, this block here, there's a line over it, and it says 2180 circuit or DBX202C, which is this one. So I can just put this thing on here. Because the 202C is not calibrated for distortion, you need to calibrate it by hand. So I also bought, and I hope that they will fit, and otherwise we'll make it fit, 250k trim potentiometers. But in order to connect the trim potentiometer, there's also a resistor on here. I was looking at this yesterday, so I went to my local electronics store and bought some 1 mega ohm resistors according to the schematic. This is not very well documented, but in the schematic it says that I need 1 mega ohm resistors. So I'm going to start with putting all the resistors on the PCB. Now I'm starting with the resistors because the resistors are the flattest components. Yeah, they are almost flush to the board. And I want to have it as flat as possible so that if I turn it around to solder it, then I can use a little tiny bit of force to keep them flush to the PCB. We don't want to have an ugly PCB. Now there are a lot of different resistors. It doesn't even fit in the shot. I sorted them out to 1 mega ohm all the way down to the small ohms resistors, like 100 ohm, 47 ohm, that kind of stuff. And I've got some diodes as well. Diodes have the same shape as a resistor. Their function is totally different. It's a very boring thing to do. So here the PCB says it draws a resistor symbol, which says 1M. I have a resistor here that is 1M, 1 mega ohm. So I'm going to open the bag, get the thing out of here.
Put it in here like this, and then on the back I fold the legs down so that it stays in there.
And I'm going to do that now a few hundred times, I think. Yeah, this is a very boring part of building something that is electronic. Stuffing the resistors. There are always a lot of them and it's always very boring. All right, so we're now half an hour later, I think, and I have all the resistors on there. I do not have the diodes yet because I have a story about the diodes, which I first want to tell. But I first want to solder these on so that I have a bit of room on the back, because look at this mess. It's now a matter of literally soldering every single part to the board. So for instance, here are two resistors very close to each other. One, the signal is coming from here. You can see the trace. The other one is connected to ground. So if these two touch, then I do not have a good connection. So I really have to be careful with soldering this PCB. Gyrath himself said actually that it was one of his older PCB designs and that it's sometimes a bit too crowded on here. All right, so they are all soldered on there right now, as you can see. So we are actually already pretty far if you see it like this. It's a lot of work filling a PCB and soldering everything. Next step are the diodes. There are a few diodes on here. We can see them here. Here is one. If we look at a diode, this is a diode. You can see that on this side, it has a black ring. And the black ring should go at the side of the bar of the symbol. So in this case, the black ring has to go on the downside. So like this. So it's very important that this is done correctly. A diode is like a check valve. And if you do it the other way around, then almost no current passes through it. And well, I'm pretty sure that it won't work correctly when you fit them the other way around. Or maybe something will not function then. Depends a bit on where you did it. Anyway, the next step is one of my favorites. It's the
full bridge rectifier.
That's right, not a puny single diode rectifier. No, it's a full bridge rectifier. Only people that watch Electro Boom get this joke. Let me think, a full bridge rectifier, I think it's not polarized, or is it? No, I think it is. Plus, it's on the back, it says it on the back, plus. So the plus has to go there. So full bridge rectifier, which gives us a lot more power actually. It rectifies both the positive and the negative side of the cycle. It's always better, full bridge is always better. I think that the next part will be all the capacitors. These red ones are actually special audio capacitors. And of course all the sockets. So let me check, are these polarized? You can actually see it on the PCB if it's polarized or not. If it's polarized, then it shows a little plus. And if it's unpolarized, so for instance a ceramic one, then it shows just two lines like this. All right, so they are in now as well. Look at how colorful it starts to look. I like that. A small story about the title of this video. In the title, I'm calling this a glue compressor. And that's a clickbaity way of saying the SSL compressor. Because this compressor comes from the SSL console, the 4000 console. It was in there just to compress your bus. And people started to call it the glue compressor because it had a certain sound to it, which people described as glue. That's of course okay, because then at least you have a way of talking to each other and understanding each other. But then a lot of super smart marketeers stepped in and started to create glue compression plugins, which are absolutely not an SSL bus compressor, because if you want an SSL bus compressor, then you buy an SSL, or you try to build one yourself, which is still not an SSL bus compressor because it's not from SSL. Anyway, I think that there are a lot more types of compression, so compression brands, that you can actually call a glue compressor. I think glue compression has more to do with how you configure your compressor than with the actual compressor design. Because this compressor as well, but all other compressors, they will sound equally as shit in the wrong hands. So that's what I think of glue compression. I think it's an overused, weird term that doesn't mean what it originally meant it back in the days. All right, so now it is time to mount the VGAs, the most expensive component, or the most expensive components of this build. Is now going to be mated with the PCB. And I think they should fit like this. It doesn't really fit. Kind of an issue right now because it... How am I going to fix this? Mount the trimmers on the back side of the PCB. I think that's actually the only option that I have. So that instead of having the trimmers on this side, I have the trimmers on the back side. Still won't get a beauty prize for that. On the other hand, it will fix the spacing problem that I have with the VGAs. Now the shitty thing of having your trimmers on the back side of the PCB is that you have to screw it out of the case to trim it. The upside is that I can at least mount my VGAs properly, which is also worth something. All right, so as you can see, I've managed to mount them on the back. Again, this is not really the most beautiful thing I have ever done, but at least it's functional, and I hope that I only need to calibrate it once. Let's see if I can get the VGAs in there now properly. All right. Ah, yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah. This is what I want. All right, now it's on there. Cool. That's how it's supposed to look like. Ha, 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 ha. Yeah, is it in there? Yeah, okay. So there are a few more components that I need to mount. And one of the important ones are these. These are voltage regulators. Good note for these ones. If you ever need to order these ones, always check how much current will be running through them. If there's a lot of current running through them, you need to heatsink them, because these ones can run pretty hot. And this is what it looks like completed. Yeah, that's a lot of effort for a bit of compression, I think. So we're not done yet, of course. We still need to finish this small thing. We need to add the knobs on here, and the knobs are really interesting because you need to program them. I'll show it. So the way you reprogram these things, so right now it's 6, I think. Let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. So the way you reprogram it is by removing this ring, and underneath there's a small, let me see if I can, here, this thing. And it has a small pin on it, and by putting that pin at the correct number, there are numbers on here, that doesn't come across on camera, but putting that in the right number, so 5 in this case, let me slam that thing in 5, by now putting it back together, it only has 5 steps, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and that's what we need, because we only have 5 release steps and not 6. All right, so I have it wired now. I decided to put the potentiometers the other way around. If I ever need to remove only this PCB or whatever, I just turn around the potentiometer and I have some room to play with. The view meter is wired. Everything is wired except for the sidechain bypass switch and the mains switch, of course. I will wire those when it's in the case, because the sidechain bypass is actually this here. Yeah, you can pretty clearly see it on the camera. So that wire is on there now as well. And I think it is time to get a bit more metal, because we need the rest of the case around it. Let's see. They are both the same. I think it's just a matter of... So... It's not fully on there yet, because I first want to do the front panel. Like this. So these are always satisfactory moments in a build, because it starts to take shape. This is what you're doing it for. So we have two things that need to go in here. The toroid transformer and the PCB. I think I want to place everything like this. I know where to drill. Let's drill in a different room, not here. Because that's shit. Yeah, this looks good. Okay. So next up is wiring the transformer. Now, this is a 2x115 volt transformer. So if you're living in a 115-volt country, then you wire it parallel. I'm in a 230-volt country, so I'm going to wire it in series, which means connecting the gray and violet wires together. Now, there's main voltage on this, so we really want to use some heat shrink tube over this connection, and we really want to make sure that we've done this connection properly. Yeah. So that's good, so we don't need to touch this anymore. Then we have a blue and a brown wire. One of these wires is going directly to our outlet at the back here. The other one is going to our switch. And we have to turn the transformer a bit, I think, in order to have enough length to reach them both. So that's the primary side of the coil fixed. Now we need the secondary side, which... It's 2x15 volts, which means joining the red and the orange wire together. So we have black and yellow with the two voltages, and red and orange as the center tap, which will present our 0 volt reference. What I see is that this hole is really small, that it needs to fit in on the PCB. So I hope actually that it fits. Like this center hole here. I'll just solder them to the back on the pads, yeah. I think that's a better idea. And then the yellow one, I'm going to put that one through the hole. Put the black one on the other side like this. And then, in theory, our project is finished, I think. Now, here's a simple trick that I'm always using when I'm testing equipment. I only have one Euro cable, this, or IEC cable, the cable that goes in here in order to connect it to the mains. I always use the soldering iron connector in here, because then I can never solder in the thing while it's still on power. So yeah, that's my simple trick. This is the output, balanced output. So that goes on here. Okay, good, good, good. Balanced input goes on here. Now, everything is turned off on the front panel. This is going to be the moment. Let me put the wire in here. So we now have live on there, so don't touch this. Now, what are my famous last words going to be? I don't know, let's just turn it on. Okay, I saw my voltmeter do boop. There's no light on here, so there's not really something that I can check. Let's turn it on again. Yeah, there's no smoke coming from it, so that's a good sign. Yeah, I think I need to clean up a bit, connect some XLRs to it, and get back to you. So it is working, and I just calibrated the left channel. I'm now going to quickly show you how I'm calibrating the right channel. So I'm just using my normal analyzer on here. I put a plastic bag underneath here so that when I lift up the PCB, that it leans on the plastic bag and then I cannot touch the metal with the wires. Now let's turn it on. I'm running a tone to it, through it, which we can see on the spectrum analyzer. And now I'm going to adjust the potentiometer and you can see the harmonics coming up. If we go the other way around, they go down and up again. Now what I try is to hit the sweet spot with the least amount of harmonics. Over here exactly. I already did the right channel. So let's turn it off and put it on its feet so that I'm sure that nothing can happen to it. As far as I can see right now, it is fully working. And I actually didn't expect that it would be that easy to get everything working. I was expecting that it took a little bit more effort. So I'm not sure if it came across on camera correctly, but the way I calibrated the distortion is by just looking at the harmonics it's creating. And when you turn the trim, you see the distortion going down. And when you turn it the same way, all of a sudden it starts to go up again. So you can search for your ideal distortion level with that. You want to have it where it's the lowest. Of course, I will experiment in a later stage with a bit more distortion, so having a bit more feedback or a bit less feedback. But for now, I'm keeping it as advised at the lowest level of distortion, because that's how it's supposed to be. I always first want to build it how it's supposed to be, and then I'm going to experiment with it from there. So yeah, so it's working. And this is how it sounds. Let's do drums only as well. All right, it's done. It works. I'm already very happy with it. Soon going to put it in my racks as well. Few small things that I still need to do. One of the things is that the power switch in my opinion, is upside down. So I want to turn it around. I think that's it. Yeah, and of course, rack it. Put it in my beautiful new racks and then start to use it on my master bus. So I'm really happy with how this one sounds. I'm actually thinking of building another one with the small VCAs in it so that I have something to compare it with. Would be nice, and then I have both tastes in my rack. Not sure yet. The build is a bit more demanding on time than I was thinking. I thought it would be 6 to 8 hours to build. In the end, I spent 12 hours on it. It's not the easiest build. On the other hand, of course, it's difficult to build such a piece from the ground up. So, relatively speaking, if you have soldered before, if you know how to hold a soldering iron and stuff, and worked on a PCB before, and you know, soldered some cables and stuff, then I think it's actually possible to build this thing. One of the things that you should think about, I was very lucky with this one. I switched it on and it worked. And that's how it's supposed to be, but that doesn't always happen. You have to think about, okay, if I build this thing myself and it doesn't work, what then? Like, are you able to find the mistake? Are you able to fix it? I'm always very nervous about that because although I know a lot about electronics, most of on the audio side, and actually most of my knowledge is at the tube side, so vacuum tubes, it's not that I know everything that is going on in here. I don't. So yeah, let me know what you think of this video. I will link all necessary info in the description underneath this video. If you like this video, then let me know that by giving me a thumbs up. Other ways to support me is by pledging a bit to my Patreon campaign, which I will link over here. If you like my videos and want to see more, well, this is actually the first DIY video that I'm doing, so all my other videos are different videos, but then again, I will link one of my other videos over here. Thanks a lot for watching this video. Keep pushing, and bye bye.